Now, this is the way structural biology targets would be selected. Okay, and there were only few targets. You see, we didn't know how many proteins there should be even in a virus or in a bacterium. We had no idea. We didn't know what the genome was. We had perhaps access to 50 human proteins in principle. And not all were so as easy as hemoglobin. I mean, there were some enzymes which then came up. There were mostly colored proteins like cytochrome C because these could not be lost during purification because you had the color to follow. And so either we would work on easy proteins to get, or we would work on proteins that were clearly related to severe diseases, usually human diseases, or to major disasters in agriculture or similar. And then a big effort would be invested to obtain the necessary 5 milligrams or so of the purified protein that would allow to determine the structure. So this was structural biology. Now I'm changing gears, and since this should be a life story, I give you a few glimpses of my experiences outside of doing science. This is my home where I grew up. It's a farmhouse in Switzerland. It's now under protection. It cannot be torn down for some reason, so it will stand there for a long time to come, apparently. The farmhouse typically has forests attached to it. This is my forest. Someone had the idea of recently making a picture of me in my forest. There are no pictures around from the times when I was a kid. Nobody was interested. It all came much later. There was also a trout river with the farm. But you see, again, the picture is from a few years ago. Nobody took pictures of me when I worked on this river. I was actually in charge of the river. We would catch fish. We would get the eggs out of the fish, make little fish on the side of the river in artificial insemination, then replant the fish. And so I learned an awful lot about fish. And so later on, I would use this knowledge about fish around the world. And fishing is a good way to find out that you only get attention when you catch big fish. Okay, if you catch small fish, you may have dinner. You may even have dinner for the whole family, but what the hell? If you catch big fish, then you get ahead. Same, of course, applies in science. If you don't go for solving big problems, it's not very interesting. If you just do repetitious work, so what? And it's about the same amount of work and pain to work on a big fish than on a lot of little ones. Yes, and then I was in sports, and I just gave a talk to high school students, and may repeat this in a more serious way here. You see, when you are in science, you never know if you are right. You see, you can do your work very seriously, but you may always have made some little mistake. You are uncertain. I mean, I'm also always uncertain when we publish something. Now, when I look back, you see, we solved the first protein structure with NMR in 1984. Today, there are more than 10,000 structures in the data bank. So I know that's clear. This was the method worked, okay? But it took a long time to be sure. You see, it's not like being in sports. If I cross the bar at 2 meters and 40 centimeters today, that's close to the world record, I'll be in the newspapers the next day. Clearly. If you have a result in science, you have to wait for your peers to repeat the measurements, perhaps, and to check whether they hold up, and it may take many years until you are acknowledged for having done this. So there is no such thing as being in the limelight immediately after you have done something that you believe is a major progress in whatever science you are in. And this is a very, very difficult situation sometimes. And having been in sports and having had the experience to measure achievement and to know exactly now I have crossed the bar at my time it was 1.7 meters or so, I have done it. Great. If I fail, I have to train and try again. But I have to continue to live after failure. So it's a very, very important school to learn how to evaluate one's work in science as well. I think that based mainly on my past in sports, I was able over the years to evaluate when we had made real progress. This was sometimes very hard on my students because I would not accept anything that was half-baked. And you don't make a big discovery every 6 months. You see, and nowadays we have to write reports to NIH or to whoever gives the money for our research. But we can't have an important progress in 3 weeks or in 6 months. Maybe every 10 years if things go really well. And it's very important to be able to judge and to be very hard with oneself and with the associates in deciding whether or not a result also in science corresponds to having crossed the bar or whether we have to do more work in order to get there. And of course, that's, I was playing a lot of football and that's where I had problems with the oxygen and that brought me to study hemoglobin. I'm not making this up, you see. My wife, who is somewhere here, and I both majored in sports at the university. And we were teaching sports in high school. And this brought me to study hemoglobin. It was a very serious thing. I was worried about oxygen uptake. I wanted to know how this works. And that got me really into science. That's when I decided, or when it was decided for me, that I would not continue to teach sports in high school, but that I would really go into research. See, when we first went to the United States, we had a stipend to study American sports, not science. And so you see, this was really, it was really important to have sports to go to hemoglobin. Well, of course, I had a solid education in physics, and I was doing a lot of quantum mechanics already at that time. And so I shouldn't make it look too easy. But there are a lot of hours in the day, you see, and you can't perform sports for 18 hours, but you shouldn't sleep for more than 6 hours. So what do you do in between? You can do quantum mechanics or similar. Well, here, you see, I think I should tell this. Once we had finished the first structure determination by NMR in the fall of 1984, I was absolutely sure that this was, we had crossed the bar, we had it, and so I asked for a sabbatical and went skiing for 2 years. Here, this was the view out of my office in Wengen, where I was on sabbatical, and I would participate in things like not as an active racer at that time, but in some function in ski racing up there, and I would gang train. I skied for every day for the whole winter, 2 winters in a row, and I published a book on the works that we had done before, and that was very fortunate, I think. Skiing for 2 years was extremely important, otherwise I would never have written up our work properly. I mean, the book is now has been reprinted more than 40 times so far, and it's still being sold after some, it's 30 years now. So you see again, it's very closely related to my having performed a lot of sports and kept sort of healthy, or tried to anyway. Okay, now I come to the second serious part of my talk, and that's now structural genomics. Again, I start with the central dogma of molecular biology. By 2000, the complete genomes of about 100 bacteria and viruses and the human genome had been solved, which means that we now knew how many proteins there are in a human body, how many different proteins, and how many different proteins there are in a bacterium or in a virus. And we realized, we had here this long, I mean, the human DNA is about 1.8 meters long. So we would have this 1.8 meters of DNA, and computational people would annotate the DNA and decide there were about 30,000 proteins in the human genome. Now with post-translational modifications, that makes for maybe 100,000 different proteins. That's one thing. And so now we realize we know only about 5% of the proteins that are in the human body. And so this was a completely new situation. Now, in structural genomics, we don't work here so much anymore. We go to the DNA and we can compare the DNA sequence of unknown genes with the DNA sequence for proteins that have already been studied previously, like hemoglobin or like cyclophilin. And then we can pick out new genes which do not have any resemblance with previously studied proteins, get those genes into bacteria, produce a protein, and get the structure. And so start to expand the knowledge about the protein universe into areas of proteins that we didn't even dream about that they could be around. You see, of these 30,000 genes that are encoding proteins, some may be expressed only before birth in embryonic state. Others may only be expressed in disease states, others only in old age. And there are no mouse models or similar for these. And so it's an entirely new world that we can now get into by looking for genes on the DNA sequence of proteins that are natural proteins in our bodies and in bodies of other organisms, and determine their structures and try to find out what their functions might be. And of course, the hope on the long run is to find out about novel chemistry that happens in our cells, which we could never touch upon before because we were very strongly limited by the knowledge on the proteins that were either manifested in disease states, plentiful, or otherwise obvious candidates for a study. Now, how does this now look with the genes in sequenced DNA? See, let's go to 2000. By 2000, we had approximately 10 million base pairs, 10 million genes sequenced. In 1985, it was a few thousand genes. In 2010, it was 100 million genes. Now, how do you deal with such an amount of information? Now, how did this come about? why this steep increase? You could think that, well, now the human genome has been sequenced, so that's maybe the most complicated one, so we are done. But then you start to think about the microbes in your guts or in your mouse and start to sequence the DNA in these microbes. And then you find out that the beasts that live in your guts have many times more genetic information than your own genome. See, that's it's obvious, but one does usually not think about this. And if you start to talk about personalized medicine without taking into account that it is the microbes, the microbes in your guts or in your mouth, which might cause the disease, rather than something that depends on your own genome, then you get into worlds that are really very intriguing and very exciting. So, what you see with the example of cyclosporine A, I tried to illustrate to you that you really need to know the three-dimensional structure of a protein in order to use it in a rational way as a druggable candidate or so. Now, how do you handle 100 million, and it's much more by now, possible candidates? That's what we are facing in structural genomics, and that's where we are working at this point. See, I show you the same statements in a different way. We have this red circle. That red circle represents the protein, the genomic protein universe. And you see, I have reduced the number from 100 million to 33 million because about one third of those 100 million are really solidly established. But that's still a large number, and they come from about 29,000 organisms. So that's a red circle. Now, three-dimensional structures as of September of last year were about 86,000. That is this small dark blue circle. And how do we ever cover the whole red circle with three-dimensional structures, considering that sequencing a gene costs maybe $2 nowadays, and determination of a three-dimensional protein structure costs on average $250,000 or so. See, it's unthinkable that we would determine structures for all of these sequences. And as I showed you before, the number of known genomic protein sequences is increasing. So the idea is that we select proteins which have a lot of relatives, so-called protein families, so that if we determine a single three-dimensional structure, we can homology model a large number of other proteins and get approximate structures for a much larger number of proteins than those for which we experimentally determine the structures. And this is the way we work. And what this needs, I mean, if you want to go from, if you want to tackle the problem of getting a sufficient number of new three-dimensional structures to get a significantly larger coverage of the genomic protein universe, you have to develop new methods. Crystallography has done marvelous work. Robotics has come into the game. More powerful X-ray sources have come into the game. We have also developed new methods. I mean, today we determine the structure of a small soluble proteins in a week or 10 days about, whereas it would take 2 years, only 10 years ago. And so we talk about high throughput structure determination. I show you here a small selection of recent NMR structures from this structural genomics approach. Each one of these represents, they were selected on this slide for this reason, each one represents a rather large protein family, on average about 800 members, so that you can see that I have 14 times 800 gives me about 10,000 proteins that have been characterized based on these structures. And what can we now do? There are in total many thousand new structures of proteins of which nothing else is known. We call these domains of unknown function. And what can we now start to do? We go from the genomic DNA to having three-dimensional structures of the proteins. And then, in addition to the questions that we investigated in conventional structural biology, we can now start to ask, because we have a large number of structures, where will it end with the structural coverage of new protein families? How many different folds can we have? How many sequences can adopt the same fold? Can we determine function from structure? That's now the key point. You see, we have now more than 5,000 structures in the data bank which have unknown functions. All we know is that these structures represent proteins that are in our bodies. So they must have some importance. They must have some function. Now, the question is, can we go from function to structure? Can we go from structure to function? This is a chance that we have to find out about new chemistry that was so far unknown, which might occur in our cells. And based on this, of course, we can then go to economically viable projects such as exploring novel drug targets and so like. So I suppose that with this I'm near the end of my talk. I talk now about solving three-dimensional protein structures at atomic resolution by NMR in solution. Mind you again, NMR stands for nuclear magnetic resonance. No. Oh, yes. I forgot. I wanted to tell you why we got the Nobel Prize, because Drozi is not yet mentioned in the citation. See? That's open. So we got the prize for having done this. And then developed two-dimensional NMR, COSY, NOSY, SEXY, and FOXY. In 1982. Yeah, this is serious. I mean, this stands for correlated spectroscopy, nuclear Overhauser enhancement spectroscopy, spin echo correlated spectroscopy, fold over correlated spectroscopy. Okay? Nobody will remember this, but COSY, NOSY, SEXY, and FOXY people usually do. So, we were two of us at ETH. Professor Ernst, who is working on an apparatus here, and I'm on the side wearing a tie. That's always the sort of combination that you need. And then there's I was in your technology transfer center, and there they talk about incubating young people who have started new enterprises. They actually have an incubator room. No, they have a whole level of incubators in that building across the street. What is it called? It's called, what is the name of this enterprise? Your biotech park? Research park. So they have a whole level. The second level is incubators for new companies. Now you should see how they incubated Richard Ernst and myself. When we came back from the United States, they forgot to build offices for us. And so the director of physical chemistry, Professor Günthardt, he decided to get a crane and he lifted two wooden barracks on top of the flat roof of the physical chemistry building of the ETH in Zurich. There was no there was no heating. We then bought electric heaters, but that didn't help. There was no air conditioning, there was no water, there was nothing. And so we were incubated here. I think Richard Ernst was incubated for 5 years. I got into different quarters after a shorter while. And since there have been no Nobel Prizes for the ETH, since Ernst and I got one, we are recommending to our presidents that he should perhaps think about organizing wooden shacks for young assistant professors and keep them there for a little while before letting them go into more comfortable quarters. Now, this is a nice picture, and it's worth to show it just for its beauty. It is a structure determination by crystallography from 1967. And this is a hand drawing. You see, there were no computers to make drawings of structures. So you would have some way a lot of paper or a lot of tape with the coordinates of the atoms in the structure. And then a man called Irving Geis would use these coordinates to make such beautiful drawings for Scientific American and similar. Now, this particular one is cytochrome C. And cytochrome C played a key role in my research that was completely independent at that time from Professor Ernst's research. It was still done in the United States. Separated lines. And these come from groups immediately adjacent to the heme group in cytochrome C. And so by studying these lines, we could explore the spin physics in large molecules tumbling in aqueous solution. And that's, of course, that's the origin that leads to Drozzi eventually. But we got all the spin physics information from here. We knew exactly what there was to be done to get the structure. But most of the resonances of the protein were overlapped here in the center. And if we couldn't work with this part of the spectrum in the way that we had previously worked with these well-resolved lines, we wouldn't have a chance to get a three-dimensional structure of a protein. So the idea came up to make two-dimensional spectra, and that solved the problem. See, and for this is a big fish again. You see, these are those few big fish in NMR. You instead of using the normal linear time axis, you introduce a second time axis. I don't want to go into details, but anyway, you get a two-dimensional time space with a two-dimensional Fourier transformation. You get into a two-dimensional frequency space. And that's the way it looks. And so instead of this, instead of this mess, which you cannot interpret, it looks like this in a two-dimensional spectrum. You get this. And now you have the information. See? Now there are hundreds of points in this spectrum, and these are sufficient. It needs a lot of theoretical work from there, but this is enough information to determine the three-dimensional protein structure. And the first one was a Bull seminal inhibitor. And you see, in addition to getting two-dimensional NMR spectra, we had several years of development of new algorithms of distance geometry and of programming this knowledge. And then you would go to Stockholm. See, we got it. Yes, you see, then from this spectrum, using distance geometry calculations, one gets this structure, and that was enough for both of us to go to Stockholm on different occasions. And so this also really founded NMR in structural biology. And I show you here in the last slide another picture of that first protein structure that we got. The important thing to say is that while crystallography usually gets a shape, which by the way looks like Switzerland, for those who are fluent in geography, that's a coincidence. You have a lot of color here, which represents additional data that you get from NMR. I mean data on dynamic processes, on time changes in the structure in which are related to function, to the rate of these changes in the structure, and so on, interactions with other molecules, with ligands, with drug molecules, and so on. And this sort of picture is sort of encouraging to go on. It's pleasing, I think, also aesthetically, and it represents pretty much the result of using NMR in structural biology and now in structural genomics. Now we are getting this sort of colorful information on a large number of new proteins that we did not know about 20 years ago. We didn't know they existed. Now we get their structures. And I thank you for your attention.
Sir Utrich again for a wonderful and
I also want to use this opportunity to thank Lawson and Toubro Construction again, and we have their representatives here, Mr. Sekar and Mr. Ramana. Please stand. Thank you so much. Thank you. And thanks to all of you for taking time to come and listen to Professor Utrich. Bye.